Interrupts and polling. Generally, interrupts means disturbances. Suppose when I want to teach this topic, I may get interrupts because of my health problems, that is internal interrupts, or I may get interrupts from external resources, that may be external interrupts. Or sometimes I want to do other talks, those are highest priority. Those are different types of interrupts. Like that, interrupts means disturbance. So generally, so whenever any device, any my input device or any additional device that requires the attention from the microprocessor, it pings the microprocessor. This ping is called interrupt request. So polling means continuously we are checking. So the time is over. Every time you are checking, time is 10 o'clock is completed or time is 10 o'clock or not. Like every time you need to check frequently for every 5 seconds or for every 1 minute. That is called polling. In polling, the microcontroller continuously probes whether the device requires attention, if there is data to be exchanged. So interrupt means, so at particular time, that interrupt will be occurred, whatever the define we are defining in the program. Polling means continuously, we are checking that time is happened, the interrupt time is happened. So we need to do the task, time is going on or not, like that. Like our mobile alarms. If you're putting alarm means at 6 o'clock, automatically it will ring the alarm. In terms of alarm, interrupt means we are putting the alarm. So at 6 o'clock time is occurred, at the time the alarm will be ringing. That is like interrupt. Polling means continuously you are checking time is 6 o'clock or not. Every time, every 5 seconds. Check the difference. Imagine what is the difference between setting the put the alarm at 6 o'clock in the mobile or every time you are checking that time. Check the difference like that. That is the difference between interrupt and polling. So the program associated around the interrupt is called interrupt service routine. So what we are doing after occurring the interrupt, that procedure will be defined in the step-by-step procedure in the sequence of instructions. That group of instructions is called interrupt service routine. The program associated around an interrupt is called interrupt service routine. This program contains some memory locations. So we are keeping this program in some memory location. That group of memory locations keep aside in the memory. That is called interrupt vector table. So in the overall memory, we are placing some memory, we are keeping some memory for storing the ISRs, interrupt service routines. That group of memory locations is called interrupt vector table. So generally, we are executing the one task or we are performing some operations. While performing the operations, we may get interrupts. Whenever we are getting the interrupts, we are complete the current instruction execution and stop the operation and store the next executed instruction address into the stack register. Then load the program counter with the ISR address. Load the program counter address with the interrupt service routine address. Then go to that address location, get the instructions of the ISR and execute the ISR instructions. After completing the execution of this ISR, we are executing the return from interrupt, RETI. We are executing the return from interrupt. After executing this RETI, again, pop the where we are stopping the operation. That address is loading into the program counter. Program counter means which stores the address of the next executed instruction. So we are popping the stack register. The stack register contains the address of the next instruction needs to be executed. That is loading with the program counter. Again, the normal operation is going on. Like this, the processor execute the interrupts. The microprocessor halts the current program execution and attends to the interrupt request by executing the ISR. Once execution of ISR completes, the microprocessor resumes the halted task. So the current state of the processor is stored in the stack after executing the interrupt. Check this one. So there are two types of interrupts, software interrupts and hardware interrupts. In the ARM Cortex M4F processor, it contains 256 software interrupts. Those are INT0 to INTFF. And the hardware interrupts are two types. One is non-maskable interrupt and interrupt request. Non-maskable interrupt means whenever interrupt occurs, that must be executed. That is not possible to masking that one. Other devices, suppose example for non-maskable interrupt are reset. Whenever we are resetting the system, that will be immediately executed. And whenever power is switched off, at that time power is low. At the time also, the system is off. These are the examples for non-maskable interrupts. So next interrupt, other than this NMI, some of the external peripherals like DMA, it wants to transfer the bulk data, or ADC, analog to digital conversions, or a real-time clock, any interrupt occurs. So like our alarms, we are putting alarms like that. Those type of interrupts will be connected to the INTR pin. Whatever the interrupts, those are happened by the other peripherals that will be, those interrupts are generated by the other peripherals. So see here, there are two types of interrupts, software interrupts and hardware interrupts. So software interrupts are ranging from INT0 to INTFF, totally 255 in the ARM Cortex M4F processor. So microprocessor have two types of interrupts, hardware interrupts, NMI, INTR, interrupt request. NMI is highest priority. They demand immediate execution. There is no option to ignore an NMI. Examples are power supply, low power supply, or power is off, or reset button, or a memory hardware failure occurs. The interrupt may be generated by the different devices, all of which are connected to the single interrupt control line. An interrupt may or may not be attended by the microprocessor. So in ARM microcontroller, means ARM Cortex M4F processor based microcontroller, it contains 256 interrupts. Out of this, hardware and other peripheral interrupts are. The first six interrupts are predefined interrupts. Those are INT0 to INTF. This is decimal number. Here we need to put F in case of instructions. These are stored in the nested vector interrupt controller. This is available in the ARM Cortex M4 processor. ARM Cortex is the processor architecture that is used in our microcontrollers. It contains on-chip nested vector interrupt controller. It contains the address of the ISR addresses of first 16, INT 0 to INT F. So these are the 256 interrupts available in the ARM Cortex M4 processor. Interrupt 0, that is it contains the stack pointer initial value. Interrupt 1, reset, and their address range. So starting address contains the stack pointer initial value. Second, at 0024, it contains the reset ISR address. Next, INT2, non-maskable interrupt. INT3, hardware fault. INT4, memory management fault. INT5, bus fault, and corresponding addresses are here. And here mentioning the priorities, which one we executed first. Next, INT6, usage fault, that means undefined instructions, divided by zero. Divided by zero in the sense, anything by zero, that is infinity. Unaligned memory accesses, unauthorized memory accesses. INT7 to INTA means 10. A means 10 in the hexadecimal. A means, that indicates decimal 10. That was a reserved. Next, INT11, that is SV call. INT12, that is debug monitor. INT13, that is reserved. INT14, pend SV. Next, INT15, system tick. INT16 to 255, those are user interrupts. Those are generated from the peripherals and software. Those are reserved. So whenever you are pressing the reset button, the vector table goes to the 0th memory location. These are the 256 interrupts available in the TM4C123 GH6PM.